Hachette Children's Group presents 5 Minute Summer Stories by Enid Blyton. Read for you by Sidney Chong and Beth Eyre. The Little Butter Dishes. Once upon a time, there was a flower that grew in the fields in June called Ranunculus bulbosus. It was a pretty little flower, deep yellow and cup-shaped, but nobody took much notice of it because it had such an awkward name. Nobody wanted to go and pick a bunch of Ranunculus bulbosus. It sounded ugly and ridiculous. Now one day, the field mice were most excited because Her Royal Highness, the Fairy Queen, was coming to lunch on the bank where they had their home. They ran about among the yellow Ranunculus bulbosus and planned what they would give the Queen to eat.
"The whitest bread, cooked by Mrs. Badger," said one.
"The purest honey, made by the honeybees," said another.
"The finest cakes, baked by Mowdy Mole," said a third.
And so, little by little, the lunch was planned. The day came. The small mice scurried here and there, laying the table on the sunny bank. Mrs. Badger's bread was as white as the hawthorn blossom. The honey was as yellow as the sun. The cakes were topped with tiny cherries and looked delicious. Everything was ready. The Queen arrived. She nodded graciously to all the excited mice and sat down to eat, for she had come a long way and was hungry. She looked around the table and smiled.
"White bread, new honey and cherry cakes," she said. "Just what I love. But there is no butter."
"Butter!" cried everyone in a flurry. "Butter! Of course, there is no butter."
"I have some butter," whispered a furry rabbit, "but our butter dish is cracked."
"I haven't got a butter dish at all," said Mrs. Badger.
"Mine is stained and old," said Mowdy Mole. "But hurry, Rabbit, and get the butter. We shall soon think of something to put it in for the Fairy Queen."
The mice hurried here and there, trying to find a dish, and at last, in despair, one of them snapped off some of the yellow heads of the Ranunculus bulbosus flowers and carried them to the table. Each one was big enough to take a small pat of butter. The Queen was delighted with the quaint butter dishes. She helped herself to pat after pat of butter and admired the little golden dishes.
"They shine like pure gold," she said. "You have polished them beautifully. What lovely dishes they are."
"Well, Your Majesty," said a truthful mouse, "they are not really butter dishes. They are the heads of a common flower we grow here called Ranunculus bulbosus. Such an ugly name for a pretty little flower."
"Indeed it is," cried the Queen.
"I will give the little golden cups another name that all the children will love. You may have 3 guesses, field mice." Well, they had their 3 guesses, but nobody guessed right.
"You sillies," cried the Queen. "I shall call them buttercups, of course. You gave me the little cups to hold my butter, so what could be a better name?"
It was a good name, wasn't it? Only very learned people call the little flowers Ranunculus bulbosus, but to everybody else, they are just the golden buttercups.
When Alice Blew Bubbles. "Go into the garden and take your blow bubble set with you," said Mummy to Alice. "It's a lovely, sunny, breezy day, and the wind will love to play catch with your bubbles." "Oh, yes, I'll blow bubbles for the wind," said Alice. And she went to fetch her bubble set. Soon she was out in the garden with a bowl of soapy water and a long bubble wand. She blew the loveliest bubbles. They formed on the bowl of her wand, very small and quivery at first, and then, as she blew, the bubbles swelled up and became tighter and bigger, great round things full of glorious colours. When they were very big, Alice gave the wand a little shake, and off sailed each bubble into the wind. Some of them flew very high indeed, right over the wall into the next garden. After about 10 minutes, Alice heard a little sound in the tree above her. She thought it was a bird flying into the leaves, but it wasn't. A tiny, high voice called softly down to her. "Little girl, what are you doing? What are those things you are making?" Alice looked up into the tree. She saw a tiny elf there, a fairy-like creature, sitting astride a twig, looking down at her. "Good gracious," said Alice, startled. "Fancy seeing someone as little as you. Don't you know what I am making? I'm blowing bubbles. Aren't they lovely?" "Listen," said the elf, "would you let me catch some?" "Yes, of course," said Alice, "but what do you want them for?" "It's a secret," said the elf, "but I'll tell you because you're lending me your bubbles. The brown owl has caught some of my cousins, the little green imps, and has put them into his nesting hole high up in the oak tree. They can't fly down because they haven't wings, and they're too afraid to climb down such a long way." "But what use would the bubbles be to them?" asked Alice, surprised. "I could catch enough for each imp to have one for himself," said the elf, swinging up and down on the twig. "I can take them to the owl's hole when the owl wasn't there and give one to each imp. Then they could sit on them and float down to the ground. Don't you think that's a good idea?" "It's lovely," said Alice, beginning to feel excited. "But you can't catch bubbles, elf. They burst if you touch them." "Do they? Well then, I'll have to spray a tiny spell on each one so that it will never burst," said the elf. "That's easy. Alice, let me catch the next one you blow." Alice blew a beauty. The elf took a thread from an old spider's web and neatly lassoed the bubble as it rose upwards on the wind. Alice blew another. The elf lassoed that one too, with another thread. It was great fun to blow bubbles and to watch the tiny creature catch each one with a length of spider thread. The thread was sticky, as spider thread always is, and a thread stuck fast to the bubble, so that it looked like a party balloon. A balloon on a spider string. "I want 8, said the elf. "Can you count to 8? "Oh yes, 2 more and you'll have 8, said Alice, and blew another one. Each time the elf caught one, he emptied a tiny spell on it from a bottle. Alice was sure that the bubble shouldn't burst. How truly wonderful! Soon, the elf had 8 bubbles on 8 strings, and he held the ends in his tiny hand. "I'm going now," he said. "Are you coming to watch?" "Oh, yes," said Alice, and she followed the elf down the garden, through the hedge, and into the wood. He flew on ahead with a string of bubbles, his tiny wings fluttering like moth wings. Soon he came to a big oak tree. "They're all up here," he said, and flew up into the tree. He disappeared into a hole. Almost at once, a crowd of tiny green imps came out and sat in a row on a bough. The elf gave them each a string to hold. "Now, shorten your string and pull the balloon to you," he said. "Jump astride it when it comes near enough and let the wind float you off the bough. Don't be afraid it won't burst. You'll land quite safely on the ground." Each imp pulled his bubble towards him and cleverly jumped on top of it as it came near. Then off they floated on the breeze, some lying face downwards on the balloon, some sitting astride, and one little fellow swinging underneath. Alice could hardly breathe for excitement. She was glad when they all reached the ground safely. They handed the strings to the elf and scampered off down a rabbit hole like a lot of green mice. "It's very kind of you to help like this," said the elf. "Do let me give you something. Is there anything you would like?" "Well, do you think I could have my 8 bubbles back?" asked Alice. "But why?" said the imp, surprised. "You can blow plenty more." "Yes, I know, but you've put a spell on these so they won't break," said Alice. and I have never heard of any boy or girl who has ever had unbreakable bubbles before. I could keep them in my bedroom, and they would always float about and look simply lovely. Tame bubbles. Think of that. Oh, of course. Keep them then, said the elf, laughing. I'm so glad I happened to see you blowing them. I couldn't think how to rescue my cousins. Well, Alice took the balloons carefully back home, still on their strings. When she got home, she pulled away the spider thread strings and let the balloons loose. They floated up and down her room, bouncing against the bed and the mantelpiece and the chairs, but never breaking. And you will hardly believe it, but Alice still has 5 of them left. They float about her bedroom all day and night, like little fairy balloons. The other 3 flew out of the window one day, when it was wide open. I do wonder how long she'll keep the ones that are left.
Trundle goes out to tea. If ever you go to the little pixie village of Tucked Away, you will notice a curious thing. You will see that every pixie wears a green leaf sewn onto his tight little breeches, just over his right kneecap. And you are sure to wonder why. Well, I will tell you the reason, because I'm sure you won't like to ask the pixies. We shall have to go right back to the day when Trundle the pixie went out to tea. Now, Trundle didn't live in the village of Tucked Away. Oh dear me, no. He lived in the town of Very Big, where everything was up to date, and all the pixies wore the very latest thing in pointed caps and knew how many buttons should go on a coat and important things like that. The pixies of Tucked Away were very old-fashioned, although they tried hard not to be. As Trundle said, they simply did not know how to dress. They wore 15 buttons down their coats when everyone in Very Big was only wearing 14 and had 5 pockets instead of 2. The village of Tucked Away thought a lot of Very Big, and whenever a visitor from the town paid them a visit, they were very excited. They made everything as nice as they could and tried their hardest to show the visitor that they could do things quite as well as Very Big. So you can imagine that when Trundle said he would go and have tea with his cousin in Tucked Away, there was great excitement. Trundle was a very up-to-date pixie and always dressed just so. Jinx, his cousin, couldn't keep the news to himself when he got Trundle's letter, and he rushed round to all his friends to tell them that a pixie from Very Big was coming to tea the very next Friday. "I'll have a tea party," he said, "and you must all come, dressed in your very best things, and we'll show Trundle that the village of Tucked Away can be just as well dressed as the town of Very Big." So everyone began to take out their best suits and sponge them and iron them. They polished up the buttons and put clean handkerchiefs in the breast pockets, all ready for the tea party. Jinx made lots of scones and cakes and bought 3 different sorts of jam from the jam woman. He made a yellow jelly and a red one, and when the day came, you should have seen his tea table. It was enough to make your mouth water. The pixies, going by his cottage in the morning, peeped in through the window, and what they saw made them long for the afternoon to come. Jinx had asked everybody to come at 4 o'clock. Trundle was coming at 3:30, and Jinx thought that his visitor would just have time to wash and polish up his shoes before all the guests arrived. At 2:30, Trundle started out from the town of Very Big to walk to Tucked Away, which was 4 miles away. He had on his newest suit and a fine new hat with a red feather in it. He liked his cousin Jinx, and he was looking forward to the tea party, for he hadn't had much lunch. He went merrily along, whistling a tune, walking in the shade, for the sun was hot. He was very nearly at Tucked Away when a dreadful thing happened. Trundle caught his foot on a root and tumbled right over, and when he got up again, he found that he had torn a big hole in his nice red breeches just over his right kneecap. "Oh, my," said Trundle in dismay. "Now, isn't that unfortunate?
Never mind. Jinx is sure to offer me a needle and thread when I get to his house, and I'll just have to mend it as best I can.
He took a green leaf and tucked it into the hole, for his knee was grazed and bleeding a little, and he didn't want his socks to be stained. Then he went on his way again, and soon arrived at Jinx's little cottage. Jinx was at the door to greet him, and took him indoors to wash after his dusty walk. Jinx looked at his cousin's suit carefully, and decided that his own was just as fashionable. And then he caught sight of the green leaf stuck over Trundle's kneecap.
"Dear me," he thought. "That's a new idea, surely. I suppose it's a sort of trimming. Dear, dear, dear. And not one of my guests will be in fashion now, for none of us has got green leaf trimming on his right knee. What can I do? There's half an hour before the tea party begins, so perhaps there's just time to send little notes round and tell everyone to wear a green leaf sewn on their right knee."
"The guests won't be here for a little while, Trundle," said Jinx to his visitor. "Would you like to go and sit out in the garden and rest after your long walk?"
So while Trundle was resting in the garden, Jinx hurriedly wrote lots of little notes and gave them to his servant to deliver. "Please be sure to wear a green leaf as a trimming sewn over your right kneecap," said each note. "It is the latest fashion and very big. Trundle is wearing one this afternoon." You can guess that when the guests received these notes, they all rushed out in a great hurry and got green leaves to sew on their right kneecaps. That took time, so they were all a bit late when they arrived. Trundle fell fast asleep in the garden, and when he awoke, he saw the first of the guests coming in at the gate.
"My goodness," he cried, "I haven't mended this hole in the knee of my breeches. Whatever will the guests think of me?"
He got up to go and shake hands with the little pixie coming into the garden. When he saw the first one, he was very much astonished.
"What an extraordinary thing," he thought. "Here's another pixie who must have tumbled down and torn his suit too, because he's got a green leaf over his kneecap like me."
His astonishment was even greater when he saw that the second pixie had a green leaf over his knee as well, and the third one, and the fourth, and his cousin, who certainly hadn't when he had met him at the door.
"Bless us! They've all got green leaves on their knees," thought Trundle, in the greatest amazement. "Am I in a dream or what?"
He thought he really couldn't be, for the cakes tasted just like real ones, and as for the jelly, it was simply lovely. All the pixies seemed so very pleased with themselves and looked proudly, first at Trundle's leaf-trimmed knee and then at their own. Trundle was more and more puzzled, until a pixie suddenly helped him to solve the mystery.
"Such a pretty new fashion, the leaf trimming on the knee, isn't it?" said the pixie to Trundle. "As you see, tucked away is not behind very big in fashion."
"Well," thought Trundle, "why in the world do they think that there's a fashion of that sort in very big? There certainly isn't and never will be. I wonder, is it possible that Jinx thought I was wearing this leaf as a sort of trimming, and didn't guess I'd tumbled down and torn my breeches? He certainly didn't offer me a needle and thread to mend it with, as I thought he would. I suppose he sent round notes to all the guests to tell them to wear leaves too, so as to be in the fashion. Oh, dear me, what a joke!"
Trundle had guessed quite rightly, and it made him smile to look round the tea party and see everyone proudly wearing leaves over their right knees, thinking that they were very fashionable indeed. "I mustn't let them know that there's no such fashion," he thought. "They would be so terribly upset. But oh dear, if this isn't the very funniest thing that ever I saw." Trundle tried his hardest not to laugh, for he was a kind-hearted pixie. But for once, he was quite glad when the party came to an end. He wanted to laugh and laugh. And all the way home, he did laugh. You should just have heard him. Even the rabbits peeped out of their holes and laughed too, although they didn't know why. From that day to this, the village of Tucked Away has kept to the fashion. So if ever you meet a pixie wearing a green leaf on his right knee, you will know where he comes from.
What a funny thing to do. Janet was pleased because Auntie Laura had given her some Shirley poppy seeds to plant in her garden. "Wait for a fine day, just after rain," said Auntie Laura. "Then shake them gently out of the envelope into a sunny patch of ground. Cover them up with a fine soil and wait for them to grow." Janet shook them in the packet. They made a nice, dry, rustly noise. "They are seeds I took from my own Shirley poppies for you last summer," said Auntie Laura. "They were such fine ones and made so much seed. I have some for myself, some for you, and some for your cousin John. He is going to plant his too. I've given him some in an envelope, just like yours. You will have to see who's come up first." Janet hoped hers would. John lived next door, so she would easily be able to see if hers came up first. "Don't plant them just yet," said Auntie Laura. "It's a bit too early. And do keep your seeds carefully, Janet. Don't lose them. You can be so careless, you know." Janet knew. People were always telling her how careless she was. She lost things, she broke things, she made silly mistakes. But she really would be careful with her poppy seeds. She went to put them in the drawer of her dressing table, where her handkerchiefs, stockings, and brooches were. They would be quite safe there. The next day, Janet went to a party, and every child had a dip in a bran tub. It was very exciting. You put your hand down into the bran and felt about. Soon your fingers touched a parcel, and you could feel it and see if you thought it was anything exciting. If you didn't think so, you could feel about again and find something else. Janet felt about and found a thin little parcel that felt quite exciting. So she pulled it out of the tub and undid the paper. "Oh, it's a necklace," she said in delight. "Isn't it pretty? It's made of tiny beads of all colours. I shall love wearing it." She put it on, and it looked very pretty on her silk party frock. Janet felt very grand. But, as usual, she was careless, and as she danced round playing musical chairs, she caught her hand in the new little necklace and snapped it. In a second, the little coloured beads ran all over the place. Some went down Janet's neck, some fell on the carpet, some dropped onto a chair. "Oh, my lovely necklace that I got out of the bran tub," said Janet, almost in tears. "Don't cry," said a grown-up. "We'll soon find the beads for you. Then you can thread them together again when you get home. That will be a nice thing to do. Look, here are some. Oh, and there are some more." All the children helped to find the little glass beads. "What shall we do with them?" they said, holding them in their hands. "Where shall we put them?" "I'll find an envelope," said the grown-up, and went to a desk. She came back with a white envelope and everyone put the beads into it. It was licked up and stuck. Janet took it and put it into her pocket. "Thank you," she said. "I'll thread them when I have time at home and make a lovely necklace again." When she got home, she told her mother all about the broken necklace and wanted to thread it before she went to bed. But mother wouldn't let her. "Oh no," she said. "It's very late, dear. You can thread the beads tomorrow. Put them into your drawer and you'll keep them safe there." So Janet went up to bed and popped the envelope of beads into her dressing table drawer. Now there were two envelopes there, one with poppy seeds in and one with glass beads. Janet forgot about the beads and there they stayed, hidden in their envelope. Then there came a fine sunny day after a day of showers, and the gardener began to plant his seeds in the garden. "Haven't you any seeds to plant?" he said to Janet. "You ought to plant them today if you have.
It's just right.
Oh, yes. I've got some Shirley poppy seed that my Auntie Laura gave me, said Janet, remembering. I'll go and get them. As she was running indoors, her cousin John popped his head over the wall. Janet, Janet, he called. I am planting my seeds today that Auntie Laura gave me. Are you planting yours? Yes, said Janet. Oh, good. We'll plant them the same day, so they ought to come up the same day. We'll watch and see. She ran upstairs in a hurry and opened her dressing table drawer. She took out the first envelope she saw, but it wasn't the one with the seeds in. It was the one with the beads in. Janet rushed downstairs and into the garden. She went to her own little patch. It had one rose.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.